losing all the time. Time. Right? Where this is an asset we can never keep. We can never hold on to this hour, this minute, this second. It is leaving us, and it will continue to leave us. It is not something you can store and use later on. It is something that, and by the way, we have lost a lot of time already. There, you know, you look back in your life and you say, there are so many opportunities I could have taken advantage of and I didn't. I could have used my time better, but I didn't. I had this opportunity and that opportunity, but I didn't make the most of my time. So there's this regret about time that has already passed away. And you should use that regret to transform the way you're going to use your time in the future. But essentially, Allah has tied two things together. The idea of thinking about human loss, and associated that with the passage of time. In other words, how we understand that now in Surah Al-Asr is Allah is bringing time as a witness to something. What is time supposed to witness? That no doubt human beings are immersed in loss. What does that mean? That means many, many, many human beings. And as we study the exact commentary of the Mufassirun, this will become more clear. But to make it very brief and simple right now, for now at least, is the following. You and I, and humanity at large, they run after things. We run after things that are actually distractions from our real purpose in life. That should remind you of a surah we studied, the one before this. Al-Hakum At-Takathur. It deluded you. The want of more, the mutually shared urge to get more and more, it distracted you from your real purpose. Most humanity is distracted running after the wrong thing. They're running after the wrong thing. Now, are we the first people to run after wealth? Or to run after a house, or to run after getting married to a beautiful woman, or this or that, whatever it may be. Are we the first to run after these things, or were there people before that ran after these things too? They were. And people ran after them thinking that they are going to have success. When they get them, they will have success. And time, Allah made time a witness that people came, and they ran after these things, and they failed. And then other people came, and they ran after these things, and they failed again. And other people came and did the same thing again. Thousands upon thousands of years, hundreds upon hundreds of generations, one after another, the same drama over and over again, and one creation of Allah has been watching it happen. It's witness to this thing over and over again. It's almost as though when it sees our struggles, it says, here we go again. Here's another one. So in other words, time is a witness to the tragedy of human life, the tragedy of the human beings' aspirations headed in the wrong direction. So time is being brought as a witness against us, or a witness to the tragedy of the human being. We need to act quickly because the dawn of our life has set upon us. The sunset of our life is at bay. It's basically, it's around the corner. So we need to act now. It's this idea of time running out, the timer ticking away. That's being captured in just the words, al-asr. So this last benefit of this oath is a sense of urgency. One alim, he compared, Mufti Muhammad Shafi'i among others, compared the struggle of the human being that is depicted in Surah Al-Asr to the one who is trying to sell ice. In ancient times, they didn't have freezers and stuff like that, right? So the ice vendor, he doesn't have a lot of time, and it's melting away, and he has to make use of these sales and get the product out to the customer in a certain time, and if that time goes away, then all of that effort is gone to waste. He has this sense of urgency to accomplish what he needs to accomplish. The other part of the overview, inshallah, we'll talk about more about the middle ayah later on, but about the last ayah, one thing for now. Commonly, the last ayah of Surah Al-Asr is understood as having four components. Of course, it's very easy to see that. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا number one, وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ number two, وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ number three, and وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ number four. Four conditions. The first condition being those who believe, those who act righteously or do righteous deeds. The third being they enjoin to the best of their ability and to counsel one another with truth, and then also doing the same with perseverance. These are the four conditions that are mentioned. But one of the things we're going to learn today as part of the overview is that these four things are actually one thing. They seem like they are four things, but they are lazim wa malzum. They are necessarily connected to each other. They are actually inseparable. And actually, all of the rest is the fruit of the first, iman. The first thing that's mentioned is iman. And then there are three other things mentioned. But what we're going to learn is, if one really has iman, then the next three things are naturally bound to happen. They are bound to happen. And if those things don't happen, guess what's missing? Iman. So if one wants to check if they really have iman or not, they can check by the minimal standard of iman set by Suratul Asr, what are the consequences of iman? What happens right after iman? عَمِلُوا صَالِحَاتِ تَوَاسِي بِالْحَقِّ تَوَاسِي بِالصَّبْرِ. If those things aren't happening, then there's something missing in iman. And by the way, all of these four are connected in a profound way. Even if you take the second case, عَمِلُوا صَالِحَاتِ. What is after وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ? They act righteously, they enjoin the truth. They don't keep the good to themselves, now they're enjoining the truth, of which I'm using the cliche translation. The idea of it is to get the truth to others, tell others to do good too. In other words, if you are truly doing good, it is impossible for you to keep it to yourself. It's impossible. A necessary consequence of that will be you will have to share it with others. That is part of goodness. And then when you do enjoin the truth to others, you will get people that respond to you, and you will get people who hate what you have to say. And when you get people who hate what you have to say, you will necessarily need to develop what? Sabr. You're going to have it. It's a necessary, these are all connected things. They one leads to the other, to the other, to the other. And we'll explore more of that as we continue, inshaAllah ta'ala. This is actually why this surah opens up in most explicit detail these fruits of iman that usually in the Quran are mentioned in one or two terms. Sometimes Allah says, أَلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. أَلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. That's enough. Because really the rest is what? Fruits of iman. Right? So if you understand iman properly, then the rest is understood. Sometimes He elaborates it a little more and says, أَلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. He'll say two things. But in this surah, He doesn't say two things, He says four things. And if you notice, the last two things, tawasi bil haqq and tawasi bil sabr, are actually deeds in and of themselves. They are deeds. And so, amilu salihat is a deed, amal. And tawasi bil haqq and tawasi bil sabr are also a'mal, amalain. They're both actions too. In other words, what we're learning here is Allah highlighted the two actions. This is what I mentioned last time also. Allah is highlighting the two actions that get overlooked by people when they think about good deeds. The actions that they don't tend to think about when they think about doing good deeds are the ones that are explicitly highlighted, so we understand this is the bare minimum of good deeds that you need to accomplish. That is tawasi bil haqq and tawasi bil sabr included in the discussion. Know that your life is basically on the verge of death. Know that you are on the verge, on the very edge of the end of your life. Just like the sun is about to run out and darkness is about to fall, this life of your world, your worldly life is about to run out and the death of it is about to fall upon you. Think of it like that, and then you will develop that state of emergency. Anyhow, finally, Ibn Kathir rahimahullah says, "الزمان الذي يقع فيه حركات بني آدم من خير وشر." This is all time in which the activities of the human being, of the children of Adam, have occurred, whether they be good activities or they be bad activities. And by saying good and bad, what he's actually telling us is that the human beings overall, what have they done more of, good or bad? They've done more bad, hence they are in khusr. Time has illustrated that they had opportunity to do both, but they ended up doing more bad than good, so human beings have ended up in loss. By understanding that implication of asr, what we're learning in wal asr innal insana lafi khusr is, human beings are in loss, and the time to change the way they are supposed to do it is right now. This is the time to change immediately. That's one of the benefits of asr in that word. We are being asked to reflect on time that is dripping away from all of us. We can get lost in the technicalities and the grammatical analysis and the quotes of the Mufassirun, but let's think about how this applies to us. You and I have 24 hours in a day. How many of them are gone in sleep? How many of them are gone in work? How many of them are put into efforts to build our savings, dunya savings, pay the bills, but how much of it is being prepared so we can pay our bills in the akhirah? How much of it is going so that we can actually be ready to stand before Allah Azza wa Jal for that audit? There's the audit in tax season, then there's the ultimate audit that's coming, in which we all have to stand for every single thing that we've done. I say this all the time, one of the benefits of this surah and using the word asr, because it's part of a day, is Allah is making us imagine our entire life as though it is how many? One day. That it's one day. If you can transform how you spend one day, basically you have transformed your life. Because you know this already. Many of you work full time, or are students full time, or you take care of the home full time. A lot of your days are exactly the same. There's a lot of routine. It's the same exact thing over and over and over again. So if you can bring a change to one part of your day, you've actually transformed one part of your entire life. You've transformed an entire part of your life. And that the time to make that change is running out. And my personal advice to you, this is not part of tafsir, just personal advice, we make changes to ourselves in Ramadan. We make those changes. We make changes for Eid. We make changes, or we, you know, break from our schedule on special occasions, at the death of a family member. You know, we make changes on these kinds of special occasions, at the birth of a child, etc., etc. But then we go back to the routine. We go back to our old ways. Why do we go back to our old ways? Because we don't see the sense of urgency. You see, you don't say, man, I used to go to work on time at 9 o'clock. And I was doing that for a while, but then I just, you know, I got lazy and, you know, now I go at 10 o'clock.